Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon, good evening, whenever you're tuning in for our Mass today. So we have, again, Landon looking intently at the monitor with Don behind the camera. We thank you guys for being here again and again to help us pray together from far and wide. And you know how orange juice isn't just for breakfast anymore? Emma isn't just for violin anymore. Emma's playing a piano for us today. And Val Knobloch is our cantor, and our own Jackie Miller proclaiming the gospel for us. So, good. It's the 15th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Let us rejoice and be glad that we have a God who is so good. Let's begin our Mass.
Sing to the mountains, sing to the sea. Raise your voices, lift your hearts. This is the day the Lord has made. Let all the earth rejoice. I will give thanks to you, my Lord. You have answered my plea. You have saved my soul from death. You are my strength and my song.
Sing to the mountains, sing to the sea.
Raise your voices, lift your heart. This is the day the Lord has made. Let all the earth rejoice. Holy, holy, holy Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Sing to the mountains, sing to the sea. Raise your voices, lift your hearts. This is the day the Lord has made. Let all the earth rejoice.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the community of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
And we take a moment to recognize our need for God. And to ask the Lord, who came to be with us and show us the way to eternal life, to heal our brokenness, to forgive our sins, to give us the freedom and courage to follow him. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ. With the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father, glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace on earth, peace to people of goodwill. Amen, amen.
Let us pray. O God, who show the light of your truth on those who have gone astray, so that they may return to your path, give all who for the faith they profess are accounted Christians the grace to reject whatever is contrary to the name of Christ and to strive after all that does it honor. Through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, just as from the heavens the rain and the snow come down and do not return there till they have watered the earth, making it fertile and fruitful, giving seed to the one who sows and bread to the one who eats. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. My word shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which it was sent. The word of the Lord.
Like the desert thirst for rain, is your face I long for, you alone are life to me.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are as nothing compared with the glory to be revealed for us. For creation awaits with eager expectation the revelation of the children of God. For creation was made subject to futility, not of its own accord, but because of the one who subjected it, in hope that creation itself would be set free from slavery to corruption and share in the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that all creation is groaning in labor pains, even until now. And not only that, but we ourselves, who have been the first fruits of the Spirit, we also groan within ourselves as we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. On that day, Jesus went out of the house and sat down by the sea. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat down. The whole crowd stood along the shore. And he spoke to them at length in parables, saying, "A sower went out to sow. As he sowed, some seed fell on the path. The birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky ground, where it had little soil. It sprang up at once because the soil was not deep. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and it withered for lack of roots. Some seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it. But some seed fell on rich soil and produced fruit, 100 or 60 or 30-fold. Whoever has ears ought to hear." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So, some nice readings for the summer liturgy in the middle of July. First one, probably the one without the outdoor imagery, more thoughts of St. Paul from Romans, I think very applicable today. He says, "I consider the sufferings of this present age as nothing compared to the promise, the time of glory to come. And we have our personal struggles. We have our challenges in the midst of pandemic throughout the world. We have social upheaval and divisions. These are some of the sufferings of our present age. And as good people, people striving to be good, people wanting to be people of God, or to engage them with faith and hope that there's a promise of light and to love one another well in the midst of challenge, because love will win the day. That's our vision of faith. He says something else at the end. Oh yeah, creation is groaning for fulfillment. You know, I guess we can feel that sometimes. The first reading, it's also a reading that we usually read on the Easter Vigil. Story of God's providence, of God's power. It's as the rain falls from the heavens and doesn't evaporate and return until it's watered the earth and helps crops grow that the hungry may be fed with the wheat of the field. So my word will not return to me, says the Lord, until it has accomplished that for which I sent it. And beautiful, you know, it's to give us hope that while we have to work, it's part of God's plan. God will bring it to completion. We try to do our part. In the gospel, that first reading was probably chosen because of the gospel, the parable of the sower. Sowing, I'm sowing seed, that's what I'm doing. That's how they planted back then, you know. And as I did last week, I just want to catch us up a little bit on the Gospel of Matthew. So this is our year of Matthew, and this is the beginning of chapter 13. It's a chapter of parables. Last weekend, we heard proclaimed, "Come to me, all you labor and are burdened, and I'll give you rest." That's the end of chapter 11. So we skipped all of chapter 12. Some of that material might get picked up in other years when we read from Mark and Luke, because they overlap a lot. But so after that consoling message from Jesus, "Come to me," it's kind of a new section in Matthew's gospel, and there's a lot of conflict. So right away he's at the beginning of chapter 12. He's walking through the fields, and his disciples are hungry, his apostles, and so they're picking grain. But it's on the Sabbath, and you're not supposed to pick grain. And the Pharisees see this, and they accuse Jesus of, "Why do your followers break the Sabbath laws?" And Jesus says, you know, they're hungry. Even David took the bread of the Lord, you know, when his soldiers were hungry and needed food. And he said, the Sabbath is made for us to help us grow holy. We're not made to serve the Sabbath. And then again, another similar one. He is a man with a withered hand, very disabled, in a public place. And Jesus heals him on the Sabbath. And the Pharisees see this, and they go hostile on him. They're, "How can you do this? Do this on another day. Don't do this on the Sabbath." And he comes back. He says, "Which one of you have like a donkey or an ox or something, and it falls into the ditch, would not save it, even on the Sabbath?" This is a human being here. I'm trying to help this person. Don't be hostile to love in action. So, you know, there's more. And then they accuse him, you know, of doing all his miracles and works by the power of the devil. By Beelzebul, he does this. And he, you know, counters that with his argument. He calls them an evil generation because they're always looking for a sign. They want proof. They can't see the basic goodness in front of them. And chapter 12 closes by Jesus saying, "My true family..." They say, you know, your brother, your mother, and your sisters are out waiting for you. He said, "My true family are those here around me who hear the word of God and who do it." That's my family. That's my mother and brother and sister. If you hear the word of God and do it. So kind of a meaty chapter we just skip over in our Sunday readings. But it puts the parable of the sower in context a little bit, I think. You know, why is there this division? Some get it and are part of his family. Hear the word of God and do it. Others are hostile. Others reject Jesus. There's this divide. And I think the parable of the sower maybe is one way to grapple with that a little bit. I don't think it explains it fully, but you know, why does some seed fall on rich soil and yield 160, 30-fold? And why does some get eaten up on the path? I think one thing it's meant to do for us is to increase in us a desire, or to form in us a deeper desire to be rich soil for God. I hope when we hear that parable, we say, "Well, I don't want to be that, you know, that hard soil that the Word of God just bounces off of and birds eat it up, and I don't want to be rocky. I don't want to be so tormented by other things that lure me away from following the path of Christ. I want to be rich soil." That's a foundational question just to ask ourselves. What's your level of desire? Do you want to glorify God with your life? Do you want to be great for God? Do you want to be free enough to serve God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength? Knowing that that's a daunting task, is that desire there? And I believe that desire is in all of us because God made us. In fact, I think it's the deepest desire we have. But we're not always in touch with it. Things can get in the way. We can be like the hardened soil, just not giving thought, not giving our vocation even a thought. Maybe we even go through the motions and we're celebrating Mass. When the rest of the week comes around, it's not evil or rejecting God. It's just really not giving God a thought. And so the Word of God comes to us and just kind of rolls off. Maybe it's the thorny ground. Maybe we do struggle mightily. But there's just other things that pull us, other compulsions, addictions, just self-centeredness that's just hard to shake. And it keeps us from flourishing. And so we seek the Lord's mercy. We struggle to be free. I'm most, as I looked at these readings today, I was most drawn to the rocky ground. Rocky ground things grow. There's an excitement about the gospel. I do want to love God. I do want to serve God. I do want to love my neighbor. I get that that's what life is about. But taking root in my heart, let the gospel take root in my heart, isn't so easy. It withered for lack of roots, according to the parable. We can be excited about it, but it doesn't take root in our hearts. One of my favorite prayers, you might recognize this, Jackie, when we had daily Mass, which we're starting again on Tuesday, but we just have spontaneous prayers, and I often pray that for our young people, for our children, that they might have happy homes, good friends, and that the gospel may take root in their hearts. that rolled off my tongue one day, and I really liked it, and so I repeat it often. It's the future of the church. It's the future of our world, our young people. And what is it to have a gospel take root in your heart? I think it's a lot of the stuff we talked about earlier, our desire to know God, to love God, to be excited about the whole project of how can I love well in the world. To have the gospel take root in our hearts means sometimes feeling guilt when I'm not reflecting love, when I catch myself hurting another person. That I'm not okay with that. I'm not okay just justifying all my actions because the gospel's taken root in my heart. I can feel the dissonance some days between my actions and what I'm called to do. Another example with the roots, I said three things. Oh, yeah. So this week I foolishly left my car unlocked downtown, and my wallet was stolen and a couple other things. I just got out. I was going to have a picnic at the Pablo, and I just, it's nuts, you know, anyway, you should lock your car. And I didn't, and I lost that stuff. And the police were awesome, and I got a lot of it back, which is good, but that's a whole nother story. But the point of what I wanted to bring that up for was that I get home, and I've been saying, celebrating Mass each night at 9 p.m. in the chapel I set up in the rectory. And, you know, when you lose your wallet, you're worried, like, oh, I got to cancel my credit card, I got to do this, I got to do that, what should I do tomorrow? I'm making all this list, and, oh, and I lost that too, and this was worth it, you know. So it's a little panic mode, right? It's like, well, I want to celebrate Mass. Oh, I just can't. I'm just too distracted, you know. No, I just sit down and do it, you know. And I saw it as a test. How deeply are the roots of faith and trust and hope that the struggles of this world, the same of this present age, are nothing compared with the glory to come. And that's what we celebrate in Mass, the promise of the glory to come. Can I enter into that in this prayer? And so I thought, well, I got to try at least, you know, so I did. Let's just say it wasn't the most focused celebration of Mass I ever had, because there were all these other thoughts that just came into my mind, you know. So I'm not sure I passed the test. But I tried, and I long for that day. So often I long for that day because these different stresses of life. I think I'll know I've really got the gospel, that the gospel is really rooted in my heart. When something like, you know, these stressors can happen, but nonetheless, I can, you know, pray the Mass with joy and hope and trust, and then cope with the problems afterwards with that joy and hope and trust living. You know, how we deal with adversity is a test of how deeply rooted the gospel is in our hearts. And we pray for God's grace to grow more deeply in our hearts, to give us that freedom. And a third thing I was thinking, in terms of the rooting the gospel in our heart, is other people and their stories. We're all preoccupied, maybe not, but it's natural, I should say, to be preoccupied with our own story, our own struggles, what it makes us feel good, what makes us afraid, and that takes a lot of place in our heart. I asked myself this week, to what extent are other people's stories, you know, essential to who I am? They've taken root in my heart. Often am I preoccupied with something that's going on in someone else's life? Because a couple of weeks ago, Jackie and the rest of our staff, we had double staff meetings. And we shared stories. We shared some pretty personal stuff about our life histories. It was thought, well, let's use this time of quarantine to get to know each other better, to maybe be a little more vulnerable with each other. as we together minister to God's people at St. James. And I've really treasured that time. And I just started thinking, boy, what did you know Anne say that day about that, or what did? I realized I was starting to lose track a little bit, and I'm glad I took a lot of notes. But it made me question. You know, I want the stories of my colleagues in ministry. I want the stories of the people at St. James to take root in my heart. Not to just be a person who's a mile wide but an inch deep. But to let the stories come to me. So I'd ask you, other than yourself, are there stories of someone in your life that you feel are deeply rooted in your heart? Maybe someone that you met or talked to this week. We may fear that there's only so much room in my heart, you know? And yet, it's by becoming preoccupied with one another that we really grow into that communion with one another that Mass is all about. Communion with Christ and communion with one another. And when we're in communion with each other, that's when we are well plowed and well nurtured and good soil for God to drop his seed, that we might do good things with his presence and his urgings in our lives. So we rise and we pray, profess together, prepare to profess together our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, was buried, he descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Now, confident in God's care for us and ability to help us, we turn to God with our needs.
For the church, that we may emulate the model of the sower, and that the seed we sow may produce good fruit, 100 or 60 or 30-fold, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the thorns of disease, hunger, and poverty that have a chokehold on the most vulnerable may be cleared away, thereby allowing the fruits of God's goodness to flourish in all corners of the world, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to gun violence, that we may collectively turn toward peace and bring forth a world without the senseless loss of life in shootings, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those struggling in this time of COVID-19, may they find assistance, comfort, and hope, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Ella, Courtney, and Tommy, our RCIA candidates who will be received into the church this weekend, and for Courtney and Nick Sturmel's son, Noah Henry, who will also be baptized, may they always find the strength in our prayers and encouragement, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Father John Schultz, who turns 80 this weekend, may he be blessed for his 50-plus years of service to the priesthood, and may many more years of good health, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for those on summer vacations, that they may return home safely, renewed, and refreshed, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for the intention of this Mass, George Hansen, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for those sick in the hospitals, all in nursing and memory care homes, in hospice care, homebound, assisted living, as well as those on our prayer tree and intercession book, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. And on this Saturday, we also celebrate a baptism at our 4:30 Mass. So Bree Trout brings forth her child to be received into our faith community. We pray for them. And then also I'll be presiding at the wedding of Caitlin Rubenzer and Brady Martin as they start their life together. We pray for them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let's each make a prayer in our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving God, we're your servants. You made us. You gave us life. Our life's about following your will. Help us to see your will. Make us good soil that you can really work with. Please grant our requests through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Okay, we'll proceed with our liturgy of the Eucharist.
Seeds scattered and sown, wheat gathered and grown, bread broken and shared as one, the living bread of God, vine fruit of the land, wine work of our hands,
mingling this water and wine. We have this bread to offer, which earth is given, and human hands have made, and will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have received the wine we offer, the fruit of the vine, with human hands, and will become our spiritual drink.
Seeds scattered and sown.
The mingling of this water and wine, Lord, wash away my sins. Of everybody here, touched by your mercy, we may celebrate this Eucharist with full and grateful hearts. Let's rise, brothers and sisters, and pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice from your hands to the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Amen. Lord, look upon the offerings of your church as we make our prayer to you, and grant that when consumed by all who believe, they may bring ever greater holiness to your people through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
Truly it is. It's right and just. It's our duty, our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ. For by your word, Christ, you created the world, and you govern all things in harmony. You gave us the same word made flesh as our mediator, and he has spoken your words to us. He's called us to follow him. He's the way that leads us to you, the truth that sets us free, the life that fills us with gladness. Through your Son, you gather women and men whom you made for the glory of your name into one family, redeemed by the blood of his cross and signed with the seal of the Spirit. Therefore, now and for ages unending, with all the angels, we proclaim your glory as in joyful celebration we acclaim. You, O Lord, are holy and to be glorified. You who love the human race, you who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst when we are gathered by his love, and when, as once for his disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask you to send forth your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, Jesus took bread, he gave you thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, he gave you thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant that will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you the bread of life, the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on your church's offering, and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. And by our partaking of this mystery, this sacrament, Almighty Father, give us life through your Spirit. Grant that we may be conformed to the image of your Son, and confirm us in a bond of communion together with Francis our Pope and William our Bishop, and with your entire people. And grant that all the faithful of the Church, looking into the signs of the times with the light of faith, may constantly devote themselves to the service of the gospel. Keep us attentive to the needs of all, so that sharing their grief and their pain, as well as their joy and their hope, we may go forward with them along the way of your kingdom. Remember our brothers and sisters who've fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Welcome them into the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. And grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. There, in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, the martyrs, Saint James, and all the saints who have praised you with their lives, we may praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
Having joined Christ in his offering to the Father with our own lives, we continue with the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ bring us everlasting life. Again, I'd like to pray our spiritual communion prayer that we have in our worship aid in case you don't have it. My fervent prayer behind that is that you who are watching from your homes do feel engaged in this great gift that Christ gives us, which is, of course, his very self, drawing you into communion with him, his great mercy and his love, and then through our communion with him, our communion with each other. So this is the prayer. Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Let us pray. Having received these gifts, we pray, O Lord, that by our participation in this Eucharist, its saving effects in us may grow. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Well, it's great to pray with all of you today, those here. It's great to know Emma's got these great fingers, and I just so envy, hopefully not to the point of sin, but envy people that can play the piano. It'd be awesome to be able to do that. Every once in a while I try to pick it up, and I just, you know, I don't know. If it's not the gift, or I just don't have the discipline, Val, you know, the toughness to practice, I don't know. Anyway, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. The Lord Jesus, the risen Christ, is a reality in our world. He showers his love upon us. He gives himself away to help us, to be with us, to show us the way to life. May you see the Lord Jesus walking ahead of you to guide you. May you feel him at your side, giving you strength. May you know that he's behind you should you fall. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Shine the light of Christ for all to see.
May the lives of those we touch sing praise to God above. Let us sing
and sing. With one voice we'll pass the word along. With one voice bring justice to the world. Presence of God with all power and glory, the word of God shall reign. Take the word to our neighborhoods and streets, shine the light of Christ for all to see. May we all set out to live and harmony. They will sing and sing. With one voice we'll pass the word along. With one voice bring justice to the world. And with all the angels we'll spread the goodness of God. With all power and glory the word of God shall reign. Take the word to the people in despair. Shine the light of Christ for all to see. May our actions and our deeds bring comfort to their needs, and they'll know and sing. With one voice we'll pass the word along. With one voice bring justice to the world. And with all the angels we'll spread the goodness of God. With all power and glory, the word of God shall reign. Take the word to the nations everywhere. Shine the light of Christ for all to see. May the witness of our lives transform the world anew. We'll shine. With one voice we'll pass the word along. With one voice bring justice to the world.